Well, good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to our service this morning for Palm Sunday. It's lovely to see you all here. Can I just check, can everyone hear me okay? Is my microphone working all right? So no at the back, okay. Just give me a minute while I try and work it out. We begin our worship this morning by standing to sing hymn number 159, All Glory, Lord and Honour. And we sing odd verses, verses 1, 3, 5 and 7. Let's stand to sing.
Thank you. welcome to all of you and to simply say what a joy it is to be here on this Palm Sunday, to be sharing with Madeline in the service and sharing with you all. You'll need your palm crosses, and also, as well as your book, you'll need your green sheet, as we've been told. And we start in the purple booklet and then go to the green sheet and have your cross ready to lift aloft. Sisters and brothers, the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
And the green sheet. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing by works of love and self-sacrifice for the celebration of our Lord's death and resurrection. Today we come together to begin this solemn celebration in union with the Church throughout the world. Christ enters his own city to complete his own work as our Saviour, to suffer, to die, and to rise again. Let us go with him in faith and love, so that, united with him in his sufferings, we may share his risen life. Would you like to hold aloft your palms? You're even allowed to wave them. We've got a kind of British kind of wrist action here, but you can wave them that way or with your wrists. So let us pray. God, our Saviour, whose Son, Jesus Christ, entered Jerusalem as Messiah to suffer and to die, let these palms be for us signs of his victory, and grant that we who bear them in his name may ever hail him as our King and follow him in the way that leads to eternal life, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Do take these and display them as a witness to your Christian faith. In the prayer of preparation, in the purple book. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy.
The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart God will not despise. Let us come to the Lord, who is full of compassion, and acknowledge our transgressions in penitence and faith.
Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God.
Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
the collect for this Palm Sunday. Almighty and everlasting God, who in your tender love towards the human race sent your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, to take upon him our flesh and to suffer death upon the cross, grant that we may follow the example of his patience and humility, and also be made partakers of his resurrection through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen.
Please sit for our readings.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. The servant of the Lord said, "The Lord God has given me the tongue of the preacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backwards. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. Who will declare me guilty? This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks
be to God.
Our psalm this morning is Psalm 118, which will be, or part of Psalm 118. This would have been the psalm that Jesus and his disciples would have sung as they went out to the Mount of Olives. And at the end, when the choir are finished, we're going to stand together for the glory. Standing for the Gospel. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory. Christ humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore God has highly exalted him and given him the name that is above every name. Praise to you, O Christ, King of eternal glory.
Hear the word of our gospel. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. When Jesus and his disciples had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this: 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowd that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest heaven!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowd were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the gospel of the Lord. Let us pray. Lord God, as we reflect on the readings we've heard, and as we reflect on what today means to us and to the world, may we hear your message this morning. Amen.
Amen.
Please do sit down. I want to start by asking you a question, and that question might give an indication as to when you spent what TV you were watching, perhaps in your formative years. So I apologise if you're under the age of probably 35. You may not know the answer to this question. How would you finish this sentence? Do you love anyone enough to give them your last
Roller,
brilliant. We won't give any people's ages away. But yes, a roller. For those of you who don't know, it's a small chocolate with a caramel centre. I have not seen any around for ages. And I feel that's a travesty, because they are one of the best chocolates. Chocolatey on the outside, caramel on the inside, particularly brilliant if you put them in the fridge. You won't have any teeth left when you finish eating them, though. So a simple chocolate sweet, but it makes you think about what you might give up sacrificially. Well, perhaps if you've eaten the whole tube, it's not that much of a sacrifice to give up your last roller, but you know what I mean. What would you give up for love? Or for the person that you think is worth it? Today, as we've already mentioned, is Palm Sunday, where we begin our journey following Jesus through the next week to the events of Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, and then ultimately Easter Day. The dramatic events of Palm Sunday, which we heard in our reading, are probably well known to us, and it's brilliant that we've got somebody who's showing Matthew is trying to help us understand isn't about Jesus' horse riding skills or donkey riding skills, but he wants to show the links back to the Old Testament, particularly in this case, Zechariah 9, verse 19, which says this: "Rejoice greatly, O daughter Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you. Triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." So Matthew is linking what's going on now in the current time of Jesus entering Jerusalem with all the things that have been said in the Old Testament. Jesus rides along the road, and the crowd go ahead of him and lay their coats on the ground, and they cut down branches from the trees and lay them on the ground. In Matthew's account of Palm Sunday, you'll notice that the things that were laid on the ground were not actually referred to as palms, but as branches, but we're assuming that they're palms. I don't think Branch Sunday sounds quite what we used to do. The people who welcomed Jesus into Jerusalem that day would probably, almost certainly, have only had one cloak, and that was the one that they laid on the ground. It was a royal welcome, a loyal statement, recognizing the rightful king. They knew what they were doing. This is the king, this is the one, this is someone special. Imagine the sight and sound, laying the cloaks down, waving the branches. And on top of all of that, they were shouting and singing. When the crowd welcomed Jesus, they were making it obvious that they thought something special was going on, something different was happening. And they shouted, "Hosanna. Hosanna." Hosanna was originally a cry that meant "God save us." And at this point, in the life of the Jewish people around Jerusalem, it had become equivalent to sort of our hurrah. It had been a godly, holy phrase that became something more everyday. And we're aware of that sort of thing, aren't we, when a holy phrase becomes an everyday phrase? For example, "goodbye" used to be "God with you," or perhaps just when we're relieved and we say, "Thank God." And it doesn't necessarily have that meaning. And perhaps that was what was going on at this time. So yes, Hosanna, "God save us," but also just a cry of jubilation and excitement. And while Jesus is very much the centre of Matthew's account, quite rightly, and we believe to know Jesus is obviously very much the centre of all of the Gospels, Matthew, interestingly, manages to turn our attention to the behaviour of the crowds. And it's the behaviour of the crowds that I want to focus on for a moment. Have you ever had that trick played on you, where you're in the street and there's somebody else in the street who's just looking up at the sky? They're looking at the sky, and you think, well, they must be looking at something. So you stop looking at the sky. And then somebody else comes along, and they see now two people looking at the sky. So somebody, you, the other person, stops looking at the sky. Everybody's looking up at the sky. And yet, it's a joke that they're just staring at the sky. If you Google that, you'll see people play that trick on people. There are better tricks to play on people if you really want to do that sort of thing. But we are naturally programmed to follow the crowd. Perhaps you've had that experience where you're on the train and there's a mumbled announcement that comes over the speaker. You don't quite know what was said, but people start to get off the train and you might think that you're the only person who doesn't know what's going on. So what do you do? There's going to be a fair number of people who say, "Well, I'll just get off the train," because I'm sure that somebody else knows more than I do about it. And then you'll have the other people who say, "No, I'll sit on the train," because I sort of think, "Well, at least I've got a seat on this one." But we are programmed to follow the crowd. But it's catchy, isn't it? We follow what other people do. Now, Matthew isn't necessarily criticising the crowd for their response to Jesus, but I think he highlights how we tend to allow our response to Jesus to be determined by people around us. Matthew makes us think about who we're following, the crowd or Jesus Christ. The crowd behave in a particular way towards Jesus on Palm Sunday, yet they fail to turn their words into actions later in the week. You know that the Jewish people had been waiting and hoping for a king to come, a king from the line of David. And now, with this procession going on, colourful, swirling, noisy, shouting, saying, "This is it, the king is here, this is the one we want." And yet that failed to be taken forward into action. Because we often want to see things in the way that we want to see things, but that's not actually what's going on. Jesus came to Jerusalem not to ascend his throne in the way that people thought, well, not yet, anyway, but to be killed. So how do you follow Jesus, particularly as we head into Holy Week? Well, I think the clue is also in the reading. The crowd responded to Jesus by laying down their cloaks and branches that they gathered from the trees, which is a good start, you might think. A way of showing a royal entrance, an exciting procession. A way of showing respect and honour. Laying down your cloak or repaving the road with your own clothes and trees is a good way to show that you're serious about something. But by the end of the week, the crowd were yelling, "Crucify him." And the disciples had melted away. Following Jesus means sometimes going against the crowd and continually laying down in front of him the things that are most precious to us. The crowd laid down their cloaks and showed their reverence to Jesus, but they failed to grasp the true nature of his mission. This week I've been thinking of a song by a Christian singer called Chris Tomlin. He may not be familiar to you, but he wrote a song, and the words go like this. We fall down, we lay our crowns at the feet of Jesus, the greatness of mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. And we cry home, holy, holy is the Lamb. What does it mean to lay down your crown, and why would you do that anyway? Well, those song words are taken from a passage in Revelation 4, where there is this wonderful image of the Lamb upon the throne, being surrounded by all sorts of wonderful creatures who are being worshipped. And they worship, but the elders worship the Lamb by throwing down their crown before the throne and saying these words. "You are worthy, our Lord God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." Jesus is worthy of praise because of who he is, because he saves, because he heals, because he creates and recreates, because he is God who is intimately involved in every part of our lives. Now you might be thinking, "Madeline, I don't have a crown to lay down. What am I supposed to do?" If you do have a crown to lay down, I'm sure that we can obviously think of lots of ways that you could use your crown to serve Jesus. Do speak to me afterwards if you have a spare gold crown hanging around. But I think we all have things to lay down. I think we need to think about those things that stop us trusting, those things that stop us worshipping, those things that we want to hold on to, that create barriers and prevent us from following Jesus Christ. Might it be that you need to lay down your expectations of who Jesus should be? You might need to lay down your status. Perhaps you need to lay down your guilt. Perhaps you need to lay down your thoughts that you are not loved or unlovable. Perhaps you need to lay down your disappointments and expectations not being met. Perhaps you need to lay down feeling let down. Lay down your pride. Lay down the fact that your valuables give you a sense of security. Or perhaps the opposite, you need to lay down your worry about the future. There are many things that we can lay down this week. The people in the crowd wanted a king, but Jesus was a king that they didn't expect. The people in the crowd wanted to be rescued from the oppression of the Romans, but Jesus came to rescue them from evil in its entirety. The people wanted a Messiah or a prophet to show them God, and Jesus showed them the cross. There's a mismatch in our expectations and in God's purposes. So as we imagine ourselves standing in the crowd, watching and cheering, maybe laying down our coats, we need to remember that there are so many ways in which God works. There's something bigger going on. We show that we're ready to explore that by thinking about what we might lay down. There's something bigger going on this week. There's something bigger going on in the work of Jesus Christ and in his life and resurrection. Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem is a moment when salvation is dawning.
To what we have just heard, let us stand and declare our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate in the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please sit for me on our prayers in this session.
family in our prayers this morning. Let us pray. Let us pray for the church and for the world, and let us thank God for his goodness. Generous God, we know that Palm Sunday is the epitome of Lent, a bittersweet day of both great celebration and great sadness. On the first Palm Sunday, and like the crowd and his disciples, Jesus knew, as we know, that he was on the path that would lead to the cross. Lord, as we journey through Holy Week, help us to deepen our understanding of the good news of the gospel and how to use it more selflessly in our daily lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we know we live in a world where there is much for which to give thanks, and yet also a world which is greatly troubled. We pray for all those striving to bring about positive change, that they may find the inspiration, wisdom, and courage to do so. Among them, those seeking to bring a long-term, just, peaceful end to the war in Ukraine, and organisations like Christian Aid and others, seeking to create a world where everyone can live a full life, free from poverty. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. We pray for our community, our homes, places of study and work, and our families and friends. Lord, be with all experiencing great change. Celebrate with those giving thanks for joyous family events, including the birth of a child. Support those preparing for major challenges, including pupils and students due to sit major exams this summer. Comfort those dealing with major setbacks and loss. Help each of us to do the same. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, your Son healed the sick during his earthly ministry. Help us to help those who today suffer in mind, body, or spirit. May they know your presence and feel your comfort. We remember in a moment of silence all those who are known to us and who need our prayer at this time. Particularly, we pray for Simeon Patel and his family, James Bowerman, Margaret Bowerman, George Radcliffe, Audrey Clark, India Smith, Christina Wilkinson, Peter Wadsworth, Martin Harrison. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we hear our prayer for those who are separated from us by death, and amongst them we remember Sylvia Taylor. We think of all those who grieve. Jesus Christ is the light of the world, a light which no darkness can quench. You turn our darkness into light. In your light shall we see light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The following is adapted from a Celtic prayer of faith. On Palm Sunday, as we start our journey from Holy Week, we give thanks to God that we are able to do so through a mighty strength. God's power to guide us. God's might to uphold us. God's eyes to watch over us. God's ear to hear us. God's word to give us speech, God's hand to guard us, God's way to lie before us, God's shield to shelter us, God's host to secure us. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Like to stand for the peace. Once we were far off, But now, in union with Christ Jesus, we have been brought near through the shedding of Christ's blood. For he is our peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Whoever you do it here, show a sign of peace. So we continue standing as we sing the hymn 147.
Thank you.
given yourself that the world might live. Let us share your death and passion. Make us perfect in your love. Amen. The Lord is here.
Your spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God and everlasting Father, through Jesus Christ your Son. For in these 40 days you led us into the desert of repentance, that through a pilgrimage of prayer and discipline we may grow in grace and learn to be your people once again. Through fasting, prayer and acts of service, you bring us back to your generous heart. Through study of your holy word, you open our eyes to your presence in the world and free our hands to welcome others into the radiant splendor of your love. As we prepare to celebrate the Easter feast with joyful hearts and minds, we bless you for your mercy and join with saints and angels, forever praising you and saying, As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Thank you.
together for what we have received. Father of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, you declared your love, gave us grace and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our final hymn is 161.
Madeline, Hannah. Hello, I can't help myself, can I? I don't even work here anymore, and yet I'm still, you know. I just wanted to say a huge thank you from Simon, myself, Wilson, and indeed Samuel John, for all of the cards and gifts and love and prayers and support. It's been truly overwhelming. Our postman, I think, probably needs a pay rise, the amount of cards we've had at our house. Thank you. It's very, very special to be giving your child to look at him and think, do you know what, he is so unbelievably loved, not just by us, not just by the family. So a huge, huge thank you. Thank you cards are on the way out, but I write back to you and then somebody, either the dog, the baby or the husband needs feeding. So they will get to you at some point, but we are incredibly grateful for everything. So thank you very much.
Recognising that babies are asleep, just to say, so obviously we're in Holy Week now. On Maundy Thursday, on Tuesday and Wednesday, we have night prayer in the chapel, in the chancel at 7:30. And then on Maundy Thursday, we have a service in church here at 7:30. Good Friday, there's a drop-in between 12 noon and 2, and then the last hour at 2 o'clock. And then next Sunday, we have 8 o'clock communion, which will be Sue taking. And then at 10 o'clock, Richard and I will have hopefully ironed out all of the things that we haven't quite got right, because we're back again next Sunday. Please don't give us feedback today. but thank you very much for bearing with us. I think that's everything I have to say. So I'm just going to hand over to Richard for the final blessing.
Madeline, thank you very much indeed, and yes, thank you to all of you who have kind of borne with us in this service, but I think the main thing is that the Lord is here, and there's a lot of joy and togetherness. So, would you like to stand, if you're able? Christ crucified, draw you to himself, to find in him a sure ground for faith, a firm support for hope, and the assurance of sins forgiven. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.